Now, we have four keynote speeches prepared. It's a great pleasure that I welcome Dr. Donald Bastille, Chairman and Co-CEO of Roman DBDO. He will deliver the first keynote speech titled The Future of Semiconductor Infrastructure in Global Innovation Ecosystem. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Donald Bastille.
Good morning. You're welcome. I'd like to thank all the organizers of the Strategic Infrastructure Summit 2022 for the opportunity to speak today. I especially want to thank Professor Jung-Suk Wong of SNU and Patricia and Gina at CGLA, as well as Blueprint 2025 and my fellow members of the National Infrastructure Performance Council. I'm honored to speak for a few minutes today discussing a very important topic, and one that I think is an opportunity for close collaboration between the United States and the Republic of Korea. This is the future of semiconductor infrastructure in a global innovation ecosystem. I've had a long history in the semiconductor industry. Semiconductors were founded in 1959 at Bell Labs with the integration of the MOS circuit. And roughly 30 years later, in the mid 80s, I arrived at Bell Labs and was able to apply these wonderful technologies to a next big challenge, the data packet networks, building some of the first and most important data packet networks in the country. I was then able to go back to Stanford University, where I obtained my PhD and worked at the Center for Integrated Systems, where we were fortunate enough to have a fab at the middle of our facility and to really drive innovation in the chip world, both on the software and hardware side. Semiconductors have been a marvel of growth. I mentioned earlier that 1959 MOS circuit. In 1971, roughly, Intel released their first processor, 2,000 transistors. About 6 years earlier, Gordon Moore of Intel had posited a law that we refer to now as Moore's Law, and said that roughly every 2 years, the density of transistors would double. And in the graph to the right, we show that for the last 50 years, Moore's Law has held true. And Intel, the company of Gordon Moore, predicts that by 2030, 1 trillion transistors will be on a single chip. In 1980 and 1984, Toshiba and Samsung invented the modern NAND processes that underlie what's also referred to as flash memory today, underlie the key memory technologies used throughout the data centers of the world. NAND firstly became commercially available roughly in the mid-80s. And over the 35 years since then, it went from just a few megabytes to over 1.33 terabytes on that single semiconductor die, a 330,000 increase in 35 years. And this increase is projected just as Moore's Law to continue. As we think about this summit and of the four breakout sessions yesterday, I want to spend a few moments relating those to the demand on semiconductor manufacturing and why it's so important for us to focus on this area. For most people, semiconductor fabs are something never seen or heard about. They only exist in a handful of places in the world. They're very large facilities and they work in the background. But why is it so important for us as we think about smart cities that touch billions of people every day to consider those handful of factories around the world? It's really because the things we want to accomplish in digital infrastructure, in smart cities, really are the drivers of demand for those underlying semiconductors. And without them, we're not going to be able to meet this future. 5G, 6G is really the core driver of the current interconnected future. The increase in capacity by 1,000 times, the reduction in energy by 90%, the reduction of latency to almost zero enables many of the applications we think about as being smart and impactful to people's lives. Now, the great news is that 5G, 6G, 5G today and 6G soon are starting to roll out globally across the world. And it's predicted by Colony Capital, who are the owners of Digital Bridge, one of the premier investors in digital infrastructure around the world. 7 trillion devices are expected to be connected by 2030. Every one of those devices will have one or more semiconductor chips. And without the capacity of the factories, this future will be delayed, possibly for a very long time. Another very important area was talked about yesterday in transport and how different transport in the future will go. Certainly, there's a desire in many countries in the world to do decarbonization, leading to electric vehicles and ultimately autonomous vehicles. And this global change to electronic vehicle may make them the number one consumers of chips. Today, in the graph to the right, you'll see that about $50 billion annually is the demand for automotive. But if we consider a gas car like a Ford Focus, it has roughly 300 semiconductors in it, whereas a Mach-E, also made by Ford, an electric vehicle, has 3,000 semiconductor chips, a 10x consumption of semiconductors. Well, we don't expect the growth to go from 50 billion to 500 billion. Even a 3x increase would make automotive the number one demand for semiconductors in the world. And if you don't think that's not having a supply chain is impactful, just last year alone, and this is mainly conventional vehicles, the auto manufacturers produced 7.7 million fewer vehicles because of the chip shortage. The aggregate value of semiconductors in the electric vehicle is double that of a combustion engine. So the semiconductors are one of the most important parts of being able to realize this future. And if we think one step further to all the work being done on autonomous vehicles, substantially more chips are going to be required. You have all the machine learning, deep learning that goes on there, the scene and planning for the driving. And then, of course, all the sensors that make the car smart enough to actually be on the roads with people. The video cameras, the radar, the LiDAR, all these devices rely on semiconductor manufacturing processes. And so as we dream about addressing the climate issues were talked by the last congratulatory remarks, we need to realize that semiconductor supply is very, very important to us being able to realize that vision. Smart cities are really about interconnectedness, and they are semiconductor based. So in addition to the technologies I've already talked about, a mass array of sensors, also talked about in one of yesterday's breakouts, roughly termed under the moniker of IoT, has to be deployed across the entire city so that all these different types of smart services, all these electronic deliveries, all these monitoring services, all these waste management services, all these water management services, the smart meters, the traffic flows, the telemedicine, the deliveries, all these things can be done in a way that actually makes that city vision of being smart comes true. And all these are based on semiconductor manufacturing processes. Behind that sensor network has to sit the intelligence, which will be a massive compute cloud of AI and related technologies that let you have smart water, smart power, smart waste, smart medicine. And without that massive compute cloud, there's a lot of sensor data, but it's not smart. It's not integrated, it's not delivered. And that will consume a tremendous amount of semiconductor chips. So if you think about that 7 trillion connected device world mentioned by Digital Bridge and Colony Capital, by 2030, just 8 years away, there's a massive demand increase in semiconductor needs. As we'll talk about a little bit again later, it's not that easy to build a semiconductor fab. Typically from announcement to first chip, it takes 3 to 5 years. And in countries like the USA, it's more towards the 5 years with the permit regulatory processes. So if we're thinking about bringing the city of tomorrow today, as Jania talked about, we better be thinking about how we're building up the capacity and the access to a very large number of semiconductors now. AIML is being deployed increasingly, it's being looked at increasingly, and it's one of the areas of tremendous recent innovation. Companies like Google announced the GPT framework and the ability to do tasks that are as much as 30% of coding tasks. And so we're seeing a very rapid gain in the deployment of AI. And in fact, if you look at it from another law called Wright's Law, and Wright's Law measures how fast the costs decline with the doubling of production. The ability to train AI, which is a very key metric to be able to deploy AI, is actually going at twice the rate of Moore's Law. And Moore's Law has been one of the tremendous impacts on human civilization. So we have actually the cost of AI declining twice as fast as Moore's Law. And what that means is it becomes available for more and more tasks and much more quickly than people think. So on the right, I show a graph by one of the US-based research and hedge funds called ARK Investments that is a big proponent of AI. And they point out that if you start to look at this decline and the impact it could have, the demand caused by AI for hardware spend, okay, and a large part of that hardware spend is compute, which is chips, storage, which is chips, the flash we talked about earlier in DRAM, networking delivered by a lot of chips, we're going to potentially see a growth from 17 billion in demand to over 1.7 trillion in demand in the next 9 years. That's a 100x increase in demand onto those semiconductor factories for the underlying hardware that would make these AI ML clouds possible. And the desire is going to be there. The world needs to boost productivity to combat the growing inflation. And AI can do that. As we talked about earlier, AI is going to be the key to actually delivering those smart services. And so we see another big driver of the needs for semiconductor manufacturing. So let's talk about where semiconductor sits today. It's been in the news recently, an area of concern over the last roughly year or so. I think we can agree that it's the foundations of a smart world, but there is a very big global gap in semiconductor capacity. The existing facilities, as detailed on the right, have been running above 80% utilization, which is considered the long-term full utilization model for the last couple of years. The factories are running as fast as they can, yet they can't keep up with the current production needs. They can't keep up with enough needs to ship those 7.7 million additional vehicles, much less the coming demand from all these new use cases we're talking about here. Fabs, as pictured here, are large or complex or expensive to construct, and they really only exist in a few geographies in the world. And supply chain risks that have become apparent maybe the last 24 months with geopolitical movements, realize that if we look at this, which we will over the next few slides, we look at where the supply comes from, there's significant risk of actual disruption in that supply chain. And if that supply chain were to become disrupted, the shortage should become quite acute in some very key elements. So today, the US leads in sales. 40% of the sales are done. So you have design of semiconductors and sales to arms by the US, followed by Korea as number two, Japan, Europe, Taiwan, ultimately China. So from a sales perspective, it's US-Korea leadership. But in terms of production, the US materially lacks. While selling almost 47%, its actual production is somewhere between 10 and 12%, depending on the stats you use. And so there's a big mismatch there. Korea is much more balanced, 20% sales, 20% production in the world. And so as you can see in the graph on the right, Taiwan leads. And China, which is fourth today, is rapidly rising its production. In fact, not only does Taiwan lead in overall capacity in terms of thousands of wafers produced per month, they actually have, by many estimates, up to 90% of the most advanced process chips, those process chips needed for the smarts of the world. And so we're looking at a single nation, which has geopolitical risk to the supply chain, as being a key source and supply of a very large number of chips. So dramatically boosting this output is going to require us to do new factories. And in fact, the world has started to respond. 29 new fabs are expected to be next year. However, once again, the majority of these fabs actually are being built in China and Taiwan. 16 of those 29 there, followed by 6 in the US, 3 in Europe, and 2 each in Japan and Korea. So if you think about both the overall supply as well as the risk to the supply chain of a geopolitical shift, we are far under investing in the capacity in the regions that would ensure supply chain. So just to go a little farther on the risk of the Taiwanese supply chain, lithography dimension roughly corresponds to chip capability. And the smaller process dimension means that more transistors can be per square meter of a die, and if more are per square millimeter of the, more intelligence can be packed there. And today, again, depending on the source, roughly 90% of that most critical and most intelligent process supplies in Taiwan. Korea has about 8% at Samsung. And so this creates a very, very big risk, because today only TSMC and Samsung really have that advanced process technology. Intel lags in that process technology, is a generation behind in being able to deploy that. And so there's a big gap for the US in terms of actually having fabs located within its geography, being able to access those chips that are most important to both its semiconductor sales, but also to the intelligence that it wishes to deploy. And if you were to lose access to those key chip supply, it would really cripple a large portion of the country and the ability to deliver products. So hopefully one of the things that's already been announced, in fact, both TSMC and Korea have announced that they will begin construction of factories. But if we think about the 3 to 5 year time, it means 2025. Before any of these chips become available, is to not just look at overall supply, but also look at the criticality of advanced chip supply and being able to put that into geographies that have long-term supply chain certainty. So semiconductor demand is very, very strong, but there's certainly a very big risk of a bifurcation of supply. China is doing an excellent job of increasing over its overall share of manufacturing capability. There's a large number of projects going on. And it doesn't have those advanced capabilities, but there is one country with them, and that's Taiwan. And so a combined China-Taiwan would give a full spread of production capabilities. And if that supply were to be removed from all of the businesses in the Western world and our partners in Asia, then we have significant issues. And so there's a big geopolitical risk with many of the news reports throughout there that has to be addressed. And really the US has allowed a 30-year decline. It was in 1990 that the US was also not just a sales and marketing powerhouse, but also a manufacturing powerhouse. But it has allowed that to erode and now sits in a very precarious supply condition. So actually more investment is needed to address not just the current potential dislocation, but also all that future demand we talked about, all that 7 trillion additional devices, all that additional AI ML capacity. Because without the chip supply, we will not be able to reach that vision. As I mentioned earlier, it's just here, China has many, many projects and is on a very clear government focused support of industry to deliver this. And I think that's one of the things talked about earlier. One of the missions of CP is to bring that public-private partnership together. And so can we bring together the government's ability in such a large institutions as a public entity to, with the expertise of the different companies, to go ahead and build and address this gap in a shorter period of time? The good news there is there has been some initial movement. There are initiatives in both the US and Korea to recognize these issues over the last year. There are, in fact, 2 acts in the US that have been passed by the various houses but have not been reconciled. The CHIPS Act and the FABS Act, roughly bringing over $50 billion of governmental support to help drive semiconductor manufacturing, as well as additional tax credits back into the appropriate geography. In addition, Korea has passed a similar CHIPS Act to continue to drive additional capacity within its industry. And in May of last year, it was announced in Korea, showing leadership, that a consortium of companies were looking at a 10-year, $450 billion plan to remain a leader in manufacturing, which includes not just the manufacturing processes, but education and programs to train the necessary workers to fill in these different factories and to the different design aspects that write about them. And so there is some hope today, although the bills in the US have been languishing for the last few months, that the governments will get together and that the actions of industries, it was shown in Korea last year by the large and small manufacturers getting together, will come together with a multi-hundred billion and hopefully multi-trillion dollar plan to ultimately address the needs of this global semiconductor shortage. So I want to close by saying, as we think about an event like the Strategic Infrastructure Summit 2022, it's a great forum to help educate folks of the different aspects that come across the entire supply chain. As we're thinking about vertical takeoff and landing aircraft for the smart city of the future, we have to go back and really think that it's built upon a lot of different technologies. And one of those hidden well below the surface is the manufacturing capacity of those devices that we intend to deploy in the trillions to make these global cities smarter and greener and more efficient, and to achieve that agenda of the way of life we hope for the different citizens of the world. And so they have a much higher quality of life while consuming much less resources. And I think that this forum, hopefully in the few minutes I got to speak today, will sensitize the different leaders around the world and of companies to think about overall the different needs in that supply chain, that capability to actually make a reality of this digital infrastructure, and you'll lend your voices of support to this certainly small and hidden bit of the industry, the semiconductor manufacturing part. So with that, I thank you for your time and I appreciate it.
Please give a big round of applause to Dr. Donald Basile. I appreciate your speech giving us in-depth insights.